doorway. Behind this building is a loading dock. And then above the loading dock is a series of two rooms. Well, those two rooms were designed to be dormitories for the first black football players of the University of Oregon football team, Robert Robinson and Charles Williams.
Oregon state law allowed for cities to actually segregate schools.
The first year they were prohibited from living in dorms because they were African American. They had to live in town in a private residence with a German gentleman, I believe, who was a shoemaker.
The football team petitioned that they should be able to live in the dormitory with the rest of the team members. And so the university allowed them to move into the dormitory, which was then Friendly Hall.
They had a weird arrangement. They built a separate apartment for Robinson and Williams. The school went through extra expense and built them a separate entrance. And a lot of times, these young men suffered a lot of racial slurs. Sometimes they would have things thrown at them from the stands. Sometimes the referees were clearly biased against them.
This building right on your guys' right side is Friendly Hall, but it's not named Friendly because of the fact that people get more friendly by talking to each other. It's actually named Friendly after a guy who donated a lot of money. So, you know, he just happened to have the last name Friendly, so pretty cool. It's kind of crazy because, like, you can't get through half the building. You actually have to go outside and go in another door because they had, I think they built onto the building or something after the fact. So there's a huge, like, concrete, like, slab in the middle of two sides. So.
At this time, the Knights of the Ku Klux Klan held considerable political power. In 1922, at the National Governors Convention, Oregon Governor Ben Olcott said, "We woke up one morning and found that the Klan had gained control over the state. Practically not a word has been raised against them." The following governor, Walter M. Pierce, was elected with the endorsement of the Ku Klux Klan. In less than 2 years, the Klan recruited 14,000 members in Oregon, giving it the highest per capita membership in the country. From January 1922 to July 1924, Eugene Claver No. 3 burned crosses on the top of Skinner's Butte. The following day, the Eugene Morning Register ran an article titled, "Eugene Now Appears to Be One of the Thoroughly Ku Kluxed Cities in Oregon." The Klan continued to burn on the top of Skinner's Butte without any sort of public restraint. It was a perfect place for the Klan. It rests directly next to the train station and the busiest streets in Eugene. The burning crosses were used to intimidate the residents of the so-called Tent City. African Americans were forced to live outside of the city boundaries and thus live in old World War I government-issue tents. The crosses were used to ward away African Americans who would enter the city from the railroad. Additionally, the cross burning served as a display to the community, the power and influence of the Ku Klux Klan. Skinner's Butte is only a short walk from D.D. Hall. In Eckhard Tolle's doctoral thesis about the Oregon Ku Klux Klan, it states, "All across Oregon, Klan events drew spectators like a Blazers playoff game. In June 1924, when Eugene Klansmen staged a large parade and initiation, hundreds of Klansmen and their families from Portland, Grants Pass, Ashland, Medford, Roseburg, Salem, Corvallis, Albany, McMinnville, and other towns drove to Eugene in car caravans, while dozens of others arrived by trains. Thousands of spectators watched the downtown parade of some 400 Klansmen as a fiery cross blazed on Skinner's Butte. The Klan extended its hand of exclusive fellowship to the University of Oregon. It was reported in the student newspaper, the Oregon Emerald, that on the first day of school, 1921, over 500 University of Oregon men joined the newly established Klan College Club, later changed to the Oregon Knights. The Klan made repeated efforts to enroll faculty and students at the University of Oregon. Although the administration publicly frowned on the organization, several faculty members joined it. Dean Henry Davis Sheldon of the School of Education wrote, "We are having the hottest campaign you ever heard of. Here are the Ku Klux Klan. Ben Olcott, the governor, is out against the Klan. One of the other candidates is supposed to be backing it. Several of its members of our August faculty have joined its ranks. As usual, in such cases, the wildest rumors are afloat. A large number of the faculty members are supposed to be Jesuits in disguise. The whole thing is very silly, and yet is likely to have considerable influence in the next year or so. So the question remains, why do these walls still exist? It should be a point of pride that the University of Oregon was willing to overcome racial barriers if the truth was to be let out. Then the university would be discovered to have been honoring the name